Está bom, Okay, so today, just say a few words about sandwiched embeddings. This seems to be a favorite of many people. Now, the only thing that you have to accept mechanically that I'm going to talk about rational math from non-projective varieties to projective varieties. So the case of the SAG embedding is one takes the product of varieties of projective space starting with, let me see, I think I wrote this like n minus 1. Remember, there was this field or may have seemed to be algebraically closed, it doesn't really matter. This is over spec of k, I'm not going to write it. So this is what one calls a biprojection. Biprojective field. And the raison d'être is exactly to transform this into some projection. So it doesn't really fit my definition for rational math. So one defines some kind of math, it's rational, I have defined the more general category of varieties. So there will be I should say, so maybe this is S 1 1, and this could be S like this, and then inside the MN1. So in fact, this is a very special case of a more general situation that we talked about at the very beginning without doing the details, if you remember. Remember, we had these two matrices that were multiplying, got a subring. So this is a very special case. So what you do is you take, when you take y like this, v, let's call this variable y1, yn. And you take the transpose of this. And you take z to be z1, zn. And then you multiply them together. And remember that we could associate rings to this situation. And those rings will be essentially the rings that appear when you describe algebraically this map. So to do this, you first say what is the map. So the map is going to be defined like this. So the map is, okay, so right, y1, yn, and then put a comma like this. This sort of sign here indicates that I'm in this piece, pn, and here I am in the piece pn of maybe change. So this is Pn minus 1, Pn minus 1. And this indicates that I'm taking a product. Or you could also write just a comma. So this is how you define map. You know, it's the same sort of definition.
So what does it mean?
I'm sorry. So this goes to, I'm writing in terms of variables, but in fact, we can write this in terms of points. And then the image is V1, V2, etc. So typically AI, BJ, and so on. So this leaves in B, M, and I. Now, if you accept that this defines a map, then you see immediately that this is well defined everywhere. Because a point here has to require that some A is non-zero and some B is non-zero. So there is a product which is non-zero. So this is defined everywhere. And in fact, if I had defined the general notion of birational, birationality, and biregularity for general variety, then this map would be the biregular map, first birational into the image, and then in fact biregular. Find everywhere. So let's accept this as a fact. I want to emphasize the algebraic part of it. The algebraic part means that you are taking k x, where this x is so x, remember, x is always x I j. It's either the variable or the matrix. So this goes from I to n, perhaps. So this goes from j to n. And then you have this map here on k y z. Is it right?
Yes.
This is transpose.
Okay.
Sorry. Why is like this in z? So this is the product here, and this lies inside the y. Now, why is this? The reason is that this is the same as, or sort of more or less naturally isomorphic as K algebras in this tensor product. And this is supposed to be the coordinate ring or you could say the bi-coordinate ring of n minus 1 plus n minus 1. So you see, the map is sort of going out to bring this way. And this is the image. Okay. And the theorem is that, as we had before without proof, that this is isomorphic to I to never really gave a proof. I said a few things about the proof, but today we'll see more general proof. Anyway, so this tells us that the homogeneous coordinate ring of the Sager embedding is curly on the end inside the end. And this one is exactly KX. Where S is the generic in some senses, this is much easier than the barrelism. Of course, you have to accept this. But today I'm going to show the very general results about the ideal of minors in any size for the generic matrix. This will come out somehow. Now, what I suggest about the Sager embedding for someone that has really never touched it or experienced with it is to write down a few examples. First, the simplest one is if you take P1 plus P1, and this is embedded as S11 inside P3. So this is famous quadric, which is rule, this equation. And of course, this is also the simplest scroll surface. I guess we call this like in Z, except that we have a straight S and then 1-1. These two guys are the same because you just have a 2x2 matrix, x11, x12, x21, x22, and you divide here to have a scope. This is kind of crazy example. Mm-hmm. It's simple. Maybe this is the only one that we can see here. Now, there is a whole industry of results concerning the sequence and the higher sequence of both Sager embeddings and Varieties embeddings. And some of the questions are not completely solved. This is a very interesting topic. Data, I will talk a little bit about this later, in this first part. Okay, so this ends more or less the more elementary part about the determinantal varieties and examples. And now we go to the deeper result. Let me just list what one is going to talk about. The first is about the coemocolliness of this. big issue. Everyone has to do quite a bit about this. And in fact, there are more general results. Replacing the coefficient Q(k) by the material degree. And if you still want to keep the idea that this is going to be Kolmogorov independently of the coefficient ring, you have, of course, at least to assume that if you replace k by a ring, this ring should be Kolmogorov. So this is the kind of thing that you expect. Okay? Not completely obvious anyway. But this is the kind of thing that one has to deal with. And this is a big, has been a big issue historically. Settle now. The second thing is, just before my this way, the primality. Of this idea. Again, if you have, if the coefficient ring is a field, then it's just that. It's not to show that the ring is prime. Otherwise, you do the same as we came up with what we call it. If your coefficient ring is the domain, then this is the prime angular. This kind of model. Result that creeps in. Singular mode. Okay. So again, over the field, maybe not all fields. You could say what kind of field. And if you look for a generalization. Then whatever the result you have generalized to the coefficient ring, which is locally present. Of course. In geometry, your coefficient ring would be the same sort of ring, so some sort of localization of fractions of some finitely generated algebra over a field again, and that field is a loop field. So you, if the field is okay, you could replace locally regular for the coefficient ring by locally smooth. So this is the main bulk of results that you want to show in the generator. And then, for all other matrices, you have to deal with the specialization, which is a big problem. But then, there are some ways to deal with some of this specialization. This will be the next, if I can finish this. Okay, let me say that the most difficult is this one. There is a proof of this in the book of Bruns and Petter, which follows from some horrible computation with exterior problems. If you want to study this proof, okay, but probably you will not understand why it works. Because what you show is that using these powers, some co-kernel, the torsion free module, or something that, you know, all kinds of going back and forth, and eventually you reach this. It's not something that you hold in your hands and you see white proof. Okay. Now, the other proof, which is also in the book, I think it's better, and it is the most accepted proof, is by showing that these animals are, in fact, perfect models. Okay? So let me deal with this at the end. Okay? So this, I will deal with this at the end. Introduce the notion of perfectness, or perfection, model, or ideal, which is a notion which is closely related to cosmopolitan, but it's not the same. In some conditions, they are equivalent. But this is the usual way of dealing with this, which does not carry any special kind of computation. And perfectness, or perfection, would be a very hard condition because it will require some homological condition, which you didn't use up to now. Okay. Everything is generic. X is always generic. Variables over the coefficient.
Let me ask you something. I know this is not usually a question you make, but have you ever seen something about these domains being factorial?
You mean the way things factorial? What does it follow here?
No. I want to know if there is some chance of some of these domains to be unifactorial domains.
Ah. No, of course, they are, because I'm not sure. maybe not so much.
I guess this is a very difficult.
They will be normal. They will be normal domains.
I'm normal.
Interim
yeah.
Proof.
That's for sure. Yeah. The factorial is factorial. So usually it's very difficult to know when a quotient is factorial, right?
Yes. Of course, if you take the subalgebra generated by them, then that's fine because you get the Grassmann. But then the defining relations are the Kluger relations, which are not determinantal in the usual sense. Yeah, this is it. Because this is what people used to do in invariant fields. To first describe the relations, then discuss the relations of the relations. You know, so eventually you would get the super relations. Mm-hmm. Okay, so my idea is first to do something underlying these three questions, which is the co-dimensions of the set. This is fine to do the co-dimension if you work over a field or a Cohen-Macaulay coefficient ring. But if you want to do it more general over the Hermitian ring, then you should replace co-dimension by grade. So let me. Actually, the grade is easy to define than co-dimension. So quite generally, if you have an ideal I, in a ring R, in fact R doesn't have to be a grade, but so the grade of I, and we write just grade of I, is the
length of regular sequence of largest length, largest possible length enough. The set of elements such as first non-zero divided, second is non-zero divided more than first, and so this is the regular sequence. It's the easiest thing to teach undergraduate in the world. So this is much easier than co-dimension. Dimension depends on the primary containing, blah blah blah. But what one can show in general, at least for engineering, that the grade is always less than the co-dimension. The co-dimension, typically in algebra, they call it high. If you don't think about this co-dimension as being a co, don't think about this as a co or something, just think this is exactly the height. So this is the height of the prime containing I of minimum possible height, and the height of the prime is the largest length of the chain of prime elements. So you see, this is harder to define in a grade, change of prime elements. This is like, this is cruder than grade, because this is entirely topological. Grade is a more refined. This is why it's preferable to grade. Okay. Anyway, so remember, we proved this was even that the grade, we can prove this for the co-dimensional degree, it doesn't matter. The grade is less or equal. So the grade of I for any, in fact, for any major, was less or equal. M by M matrix of less or equal than M times M times M. But in particular, this is true for the generic. So the proposition is this: the grade of I T now generic, where it's always t less or equal to the minimum. Usually I take m to be less or equal to the n, is exactly this value. So because of this result by Aron, suffices to show great weight. Remember, the proof of this result by Aron was this kind of commutative algebra world, use the very principle. And here again, something like this. And again, you use some sort of localization, but slightly different. And induction. Here, 14.1,
higher one. So this is generating by n variable, which is already a regular.
Very special example of a complete intersection. So let's assume
that E intersects 2.
No.
So for example, here we are going to go back once in a while. Okay, we write set, just to simplify, set I equals I here, let, so we want, we'll consider the grade, so let J be the ideal generator by maximum equivalent by u. Where u is, let me call this maximum regular sigma, it has the largest length. It's not uniquely defined. Particularly, I'm saying that G is the grade. Now, since this is the maximum regular sigma psi I, the element of I are 0 divided. R mod J, or it's not, Z divided module J, hence I is contained in E for some associated prime of this regular sequence. Just by definition, this is simple. So we have this, so we have these three ideals, J, inside I, inside P, and they all have the same grade. J and I by construction, and P because any associated prime of an ideal generated by regular sequence has the same grade as this ideal. This is true over any Noetherian ring. If moreover the ring is Cohen-Macaulay, then in fact the same quadratic. But we stay with a very general situation of grade. So this guy has the same grid. Now, what we do now is we do some localization procedure, and then we extend all these three ideals to this localization and keep track of what we're doing carefully. Okay? So what is the localization that we choose? Now, since T is at least two, one has that G is,
sorry, I didn't get something.
Oh.
P is an associated prime
of J.
Ah, not of Y.
No, of J.
Remember, this is like having.
It's like the same grid. Suppose you are a Cohen-Macaulay ring, which is what we think usually. So these two have the same codimension, which means that this is like a component of this. Okay? This is contained in some component. But of course, this may have other components. We don't care. We just care about I there. That component that contains I. Okay. We have this. Because G is at least and minus P plus 1 and minus P plus 1 because of the first equivalent result, less or equal. And if you develop this, this is what? This is M, N, something like this, minus P minus 1 times M plus N minus P minus 1. So you see, is at least 2, is at least 1, but also here, it is less or equal than the minimum. So to take the sum, certainly this is bigger than 1, or bigger than 0. So g is less than something which is less than. So this means that then we can choose a variable, say 1, 1, which is not infinite. Because P also has great G. This is another feature of a generic matrix. That you say there is an entry which is not there, otherwise you know I1 would be completely there. So there is an entry which is a generator of I1 which is not there. But since this is a generic matrix, it doesn't matter. You can choose anyone. If you have a specialization of matrix, even there you have to be careful. Because the entries may have different roles. So whenever I make this argument, I can choose, I may assume, I can choose. It's always this kind of argument. I'm really using the generic matrix. Very good. So I can localize this. So we localize left, let me put some location here, left, top. I forgot to say that, in fact, I'm showing this very general. So this is in Rx, I in theory. It doesn't have to be a two. I mean, it's going to do the two. It's not a big, saving. Okay, so when you maybe I call it, so you can call this different Latin. Or you can call it job. Thank you.
So let me call R tilde the localization, which is AX. Well, how do you like to write this? Some people write like this. Some people write like this. So this actually is not a localization, it's a ring of fractions where I inverted F1. And note that P survives there. Let me call this tilde, it's a primary. And of course, all the other ideals survive. The tilde, and the, these are all the extended. Here that because it does not contain this one. Okay, so I'm down on some situations. So now we do something that we have done maybe before, the same kind of. Performing. No. Operations. X over R. You get matrix like this. So in fact, this is X on one, which is invertible. And think of this as a 1, and 0 is the valve as we have done before. Then there is something here. And this something here, I'm going to call X2. Sorry, okay. May I bother you?
Sure,
yeah.
So this space, the tilde will be the prime, associated to J tilde, not necessarily a minimum prime of J.
Associated prime.
Associated minimum.
Minimum. When you, yes, because when you take a regular sequence and go to any ring of fractions, this is still a regular sequence.
Sorry. The idea J, it could have embedded prime, the idea of J.
No, J is generated by a regular sequence.
But could have it. But your ring is not called Macaulay in the day.
No, this is why you take gray. Mm.
So this is
why you take gray.
So this is true. It depends what you call embedded. Are you talking about codimension?
No embedded gray.
No, embedded I mean something that is not minimal over the idea.
No.
This idea
no.
Has only minimal prime.
No.
Yes. Only minimal prime.
Yes.
I thought that would be true only in the Coin-Macaulay
space. No. It's,
yeah. So in any experiment, if you have an ideal that is generated by a regular sequence,
then any associated prime is has the same grade. Well, yes, has the same grade. I'm not saying it's mean, doesn't matter. Has the same grade,
yes. But it could be one containing
could
the R.
Yes.
It could be
yeah. Minimal prime is more complicated.
Yeah, okay. This
then
is not my
the grade. The grade is the more refined.
Yeah. They have the same grade, but it could have
yes.
Inside the prime.
Yes.
Oh, okay, that's right.
Good. this is why when we talk about grain, we have to be careful not to talk about the usual primary decomposition with minimal primes, embedded primes. Still okay. But here is okay. Just take something that I send you. Then you agree, because it's still a regular sequence, isn't it?
Sure.
Okay? And this is still an associated
prime.
Because when you go to angle fraction, so by the same reason, it's still of the same group.
Right.
So the grain is maintained.
Right.
And the matrix become like this. Became like this. Now, one has that I q x is the same as I q effect. I had already called y. I q that is I minus one effect. So I can use induction on P if I can show that this matrix is again a generic matrix.
Yes.
The entries are algebraically independent over some Noetherian position.
Yeah.
This is the only adjustment you have to make. But once you have this, you know that this is degraded by induction. You already made this computation. If you diminish the size of the matrix by one row and one column,
then
and also the size of this,
yeah,
then you get the same number.
The same number.
Okay. Minus. Now it's t minus 1. The same here. Then this is the same as n minus t plus 1. So now what you have to work is this idea that you are still in the same kind of hypothesis to be able to apply the induction. Note that the ring R tilde can be written like this. After I write this in half, see, but be careful a little bit when you write it beginning. So this is like A. Then you write here x11. X1, 2, etc. X1, n. And then X2, 1. So this is the first row. Then the first column, which is n. I call it Y here to make it. Yeah. Let me call this Y Y. Where
y is, it's essentially this one, x tilde. Let me write this one. X I j minus x I comma 1 x 1 comma I again x 1 1 like this. The set where, okay, now you have to be careful about this y and j, how they go. They go like this. I is less or equal than m, but starts with 2 and also 2. So this is the result of the operations. The usual way. Okay, now, so if you call this whole ring, if you call this whole ring, this is a polynomial ring over this. Why? Because note that the elements in Y are algebraically independent over R bar, because this set these are the guys that were here before. Is algebraically independent over R bar simply because, well, A doesn't count. So, you know, whatever R bar has here has nothing to do, they are completely algebraically independent of these variables here. And these are algebraically independent over this kind of sub polynomial ring localized inversion. In this element, but it's still a Noetherian ring. Horrible. You would expect something closer to A, but that's the way the two go. That's the way they do. So that's it. That's it. Because this passage here, which is fairly elementary, to show that once you have these are algebraically independent, then you can tag anything that is in the in this kind of linear forms with some these coefficients are still algebraically independent, which is a dimension sort of coefficient. And if you go to the original, I'm not sure whether this is in the full proof or in the transcriptions, in the transcription of Egan's proof, in the book by Gunther and Vetter, where for this piece they refer to previous paper by someone, and of course in this paper there's nothing about this. Nobody's ever going to prove this in the proof. So take it as an evidence. Okay, this is this. Actually, very
very clean proof, and in the style of even Lockhart, you know, just using the very basics of. Ring theory. This is not even commutative. The only commutative algebra here is associated prime.
Yeah. That's funny because the variables there, they are not independent anymore because you have x11 minus 1. But inside there, they are not independent. But anyway, even these new variables, they are yeah. They are algebraically independent over the ring.
Yes.
Harvard.
Yeah. You make no claim of generating anything globally as this ring. The only claim is that these are variables over this. And of course, then this is like a problem.
Yeah. This is what Bruns does in the book, you know. He replaces this by some white. This is why I wrote white. Because he actually replaces it by white. Once you know this algebraic independent, you can write as new variables.
Sure.
Isomorphic tool. It doesn't matter. This is silly. It doesn't need to do it.
I think he wanted to be very clear. So he writes this as a lemma. Want to be clearer than the creator. So what I'm going to do next is to show, since the proof is more or less the same style, I'm going to show first the result about the singular locus. Well, singular locus, this is a big issue. Of course, if you don't care very much, you say singular locus is the set of singular points. And then you're done. But of course, there's a big history about what it means to be singular in algebraic geometry. And eventually this big history stopped with the famous theorem by Seth that smooth point is the same as having the local ring at that point being regular with a definition completely different, some homological definition or something like that. So this was separate. Of course, before that, geometers would work with the notion of smooth, which is a perfect substitute. But the substitute only works because you have the famous Jacobian criterion of smoothness. But that works essentially when the field is perfect. Okay? So, K is a perfect field if one wants a classical transcription. And of course you don't have to be that sort of requiring, you know, you just take an algebraic and close here. It's for the same. But what I'm going to show is actually something about regular local rings. Now, regular local always implies this smoothness condition. So apparently what I'm going to prove is something stronger, more global, more algebraic. And it has to do again with localization. this is the kind of thing that is going to be proved. Of course, at the end, what I'm going to show is that the singular locus is defined by something. And then as a corollary, you can deduce that the famous Jacobian ideal has the same radical as this idea. It's a little bit messy. It has to be. Because, you know, taking Jacobian ideals is quite messy. If you have never computed the Jacobian ideal in your life of some decent idea, you have no idea how messy it can be. It's quite messy. Unless, of course, you are in a very local case of a curve or a surface, then you do something locally, you almost don't see the Jacobian ideal. That's a different thing. But if you want to do some global calculation, it's very messy. And most of these programs don't really handle if you have more than so many variables. Anyway, so perhaps I should stay and then we'll come clear what I have in mind. So, here's the problem. Let me write first this. Let K be. As I said, if you want to think about the very geometric thing, maybe you have to assume not the written flows, the perfect, but just take a field and zero. If it could be a field, and IT you know this before the T minor of the generic vector. Then first I say, then the singular locus of the determinantal variety. I think I gave a name to this at the very beginning, but I don't remember. I want to make it more complicated notationally. Then it's already in this statement. Locus of the determinantal the corresponding determinantal variety is defined by, or maybe even is defined by the ideal I. The reason you write like this is because you want to see inside the determinant of variety. So you want to see it as, you know, a singular locus being defined by some ideal in this module of this. And of course, what I didn't say at the beginning, that should be clear in any situation in mathematics that you take singular locus, that somehow it corresponds to a closed set. Now, even that, you have to be careful with the field. But if you use the Grothendieck notion of being closed, then it's much easier. In fact, I'm going to show something more precise than this. Instead of going around with the definition of singular locus, as I said, one shows something more general, perhaps, or a little more general. In fact, one has
see how I stated this.
For a given prime, this is prime ideal, P in Kx I Q fat 1 so K X I Q of X localized in P is regular, so regular local ring, if and only it contains this item. So it's a little bit more precise, maybe slightly more general, because if you think about this, and you are over an algebraic with closed fields, you think about closed points. Here is more general, because you localize at any prime ideal, which is generalization, Grothendieck's terminology of a maximal ideal. So, you know, it's kind of more general points. So anyway, this is what one proves, which, if you forget, now you can forget anything about your definition, in fact, of singular locus, and your theorem is this, which is something very simple, algebraic. It may not translate what you have in your guts about singular locus, but this is very simple. Now, the problem is then that when you go now back and say, well, how does it compare? This is what I mentioned before. I think this is interesting to keep in mind. How does it compare with the Jacobian ideal? What is the Jacobian ideal? Jacobian ideal is something that we define in terms of the generators of an ideal. At the end, it does not depend very much on generator, but that's the way you start. And then you build this Jacobian matrix of these generators with respect to the ambient variables. So this is a big matrix already. And then you take the ideal of minus generated for T equals the codimension or the height or the grade, depends where you want, of the given ideal. So this is very messy. When you already take the ideal, when you already have the generator, then you take the Jacobian ideal, you have something of very large degree. Now imagine that you are going to do this for this. This already is in degree t. Then you take Jacobian matrix in degree t minus 1. And then you want to take the but this has that big co-dimension. Then you take the ideal of this matrix with that co-dimension. This is a huge degrees of generator. No? This is much better. So, if this is the result, then since the Jacobian ideal defines the singular locus as well, the conclusion is that the Jacobian ideal and this ideal have the same radical. But they are never, 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 never equal because of these differences in degree. So they are not equal as ideal, even in the generic case, which is the only one that you had hopes of. Okay, so this is now the proof. The proof follows more or less the same steps. Maybe I can be a little bit briefer here, but one has to be a little bit careful here. And again, on T,
equals 1. It's obvious
because it's just a whole set of variables. So when you move on to I1, you just get k itself, which the only singularity is 0 or something like that. The only parameter. So assume that is at least 2. So first I make this observation that I can assume. So remember, I'm going to prove, so forget about this for a while, I'm going to prove this. So I start with some prime ideal, and I want to show this to color. So I have this P. Then I say, can assume that P does not contain I1, all the variables. Well, since I'm taking prime here, I have to keep this thing downstairs all the time. But this is not a big problem. You could write P is the inverse image upstairs and work with this all the time. In fact, otherwise, P would have to be this idea. Because this is at least the field case. If it's not the field case, then you have to do something different, but not very difficult. But anyway, the field case is the maximum idea, of course. It has to be already this. Then it's clear, then kx I px localize at this p, you're not localizing at this. This is a prime here because I'm taking, you know, field here. So this is a prime, so this this is not regular.
Contains I minus 1.
because t is at least 2, so this is at least 1. So you know all these minors are contained in this equation. So I say can assume because if t is there, then this is satisfied. I show non-regular regular contains. So I can assume this and then proceed. You know, once you have this, you want to proceed like before. Take a ring of fractions with respect to some element. Up here, we. May assume as before that the image of this x11 in px it is does not belong to P. So we do the same thing as before, you know. Localize, maybe call this, I will never use this label, so write it in this way. So if you localize the powers of the image here, this is the same as k x localized first here and then the ideal. And as before, you can write the same way as before, k x 1 1 blah blah blah, all these variables that first row and first that we just do like this, x m 1 x11 minus 1, and again we have this kind of x tilde by t minus 1 x tilde. So I'm going a little faster here, but it's the same sort of argument as before. And again, you know, this is generated by the, oh, it's still the same thing. Algebraic independent properties. But we're not quite there. But inside here, you can look at this. It's a subring, subalgebra. And of course, this is a this is flat over here, it's a polynomial ring over here. Okay. So what you do is you come now with this P that did not contain X1, so it survives all throughout. This was some kind of P over here, which I don't give any name. And then I contracted back here. Contraction of extension of P. Okay? First extend to the localization, then contract to this subring, call it the field. Slightly different from the detail of the field.
So this is not actually a polynomial ring, it's a localization of a polynomial ring, no?
Yes, on the yes.
Yeah, but it's still flat.
It's still flat. It's flat.
It's still flat. Yeah.
I don't need faith in the flat.
Yeah,
it's the polynomial ring is straight to the flat. I don't need that much. No, just flat. Okay, so then because of this, so this is perhaps suggested localization plus polynomial
then kx yt xb is regular if and only if kx tilde y minus x tilde is red.
Okay? And now you can complete the proof without writing anything else. Because this, by the inductive hypothesis, happens if and only if the tilde contains the t minus 2 over t minus 1. Mm-hmm. But since you localize, I erase the matrix. But if you look at the matrix, this is the same as saying that P, so this is regular infinitely, this is regular, by the inductive hypothesis is regular infinitely, it will contain IT minus 2 of this module this, and this going back from the original matrix to the localized matrix, you see that this happens infinitely in P tilde P contains this. They say P tilde contains if and only before P contains. You have to sit a little bit on the matrix and see that you didn't do anything to the previous session. But of course you have to be slightly more careful than the previous proof. Because the previous proof I would stop here, more or less, I would be happy. But since I want to talk about regular loop, because of the way I stated, I have to go back to something like this. The only way is to take the subring and construct. Now, what are the problems the matrix is not generic for this kind of result? First of all, it's not clear that you can keep up with this inductive procedure. For instance, it's not even clear. I think it's true that it's not clear that exactly the same argument goes through if you have a generic symmetric matrix.
It seems like it follows that the singular set contain
E t minus 1, the right of E t minus 1 first. The singular set is exactly this.
No, for a non-generic matrix.
Yes.
So we will contain this.
Yeah, you
and
can
then
show.
Maybe we can get another way to prove that the codimension is at most this. From this proof.
Well, I mean, I didn't use the codimension here. But if you state as a hypothesis that the codimension is that one for your specialized matrix, which is not generic anymore, maybe you can use this. I'm not sure.
I say that maybe we can give a different proof to the proof that you gave, that the codimension of the variety, of the determinantal variety, if you don't include in the definition the codimension condition, right? To define the determinantal variety just as given by the minors of the matrix without putting the condition on the codimension, you prove that the codimension is at most.
At most, yes.
And I think from this we can also obtain that result. Because
I think you can. It is not true. I don't know. Maybe. Okay. But the proof is that have to be different from this one, because I'm not using anything about the codimension. The next proposition will use this, but not this one.
The fact that the singular set, in general, will contain always.
I think this is true in general, yes.
The variety of
I think
the
this is still quite general, yes. The problem is, you know, the problem is, what is the definition of a singular set? You see, I am trying to run away from this difficulty by showing this. You know? So if you're asking me whether this is true also if you have any matrix such that the codimension is the expected one, I'm not sure whether this same assertion will show, will hold. This I don't
have question for my partner. No,
I don't know if my colleague has anything to do with this. Because this is a local thing, has to do with regularity. This is smoothness, it's a bit different from. But you may be right that I doubt that for all matrices, for any matrix that has the right codimension, you can show this. Maybe you need something more. But you may be right.
Now, we
have to be a suspension. Maybe some more. Yeah, as I say, it's very difficult to show this proposition by showing that the showing that Jacobian condition is equivalent to having this sort of local term. Not so clear. I don't know what to do with the Jacobian criterion to prove anything like this. Whereas suppose I want to prove that the Jacobian ideal has a radical which is the same radical as this. Which actually, because we haven't shown that this is going to be prime. So the radical, this should be the radical. If you ask me how to show that the Jacobian ideal has the same radical, I don't know. After I prove this, it's obvious because we have the Jacobian criteria. But to show directly, I don't know. If anybody has an idea, it would be nice. So next time I will show that. Okay. An exercise. Can you do this exercise? Replace the field K by any material ring which is locally random. Is obvious, goes more or less the same way, but that's bad. A little bit careful with the statements and can assume that. In fact, one can show something even more general, but I don't know what's the useful message. Which is the following, you can replace by any material mean, but then you have to change a little bit the equivalence and say that for any P such that localization and contraction to the base ring is already regular, then, which is a stupid way of generalizing this. But this is interesting, because sometimes your base ring is not a field. You cannot count on this forever in your life. Essentially because you work with the varieties and so on. And you know, sometimes your base ring is the coordinate ring of a variety, it's not the human. And next time I will show that the primeness, the primality of the ideal, under the hypothesis the base ring is the domain. But for this I will use a small consequence of the fact that I know that the ideal is already perfect and I have not proved it. So I will assume that I know that the ideal is perfect. And this will come later, okay? And the proof is more or less along the same lines.